Hello, Tommy. Hey Tommy, hey Aditya.
Hello.
Hello. Hi Michael.
Hello.
Pop, you made it.
Yeah, I pushed my flight a day. I need to keep Michael Lieberman in check. So I was just like, that's it. He gets a little, crazy sometimes. You got to keep him,
I could just disappear now. I don't have to be here. Hello, everyone. Gonna wait a little bit longer to let folks join in and pile in.
Emily, you want me to facilitate this just because,
You are more than welcome to facilitate today.
Yeah, no worries. I apologize. I thought, like I said, I thought I was going to be traveling today, so.
No worries. The agenda is posted on the documents. So we're supposed to be allowing Michael presenting on Nix and Basil. And then we're going to continue going through the best practices, hopefully, to finish that today. And then if we have time, work on those user stories some more.
So we just give me another minute and then we'll get started. All right. All righty, I guess let's get started. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Tag Security Supply Chain meeting for July 1st. Just a reminder to everyone, this call is being recorded. We also adhere to the CNCF Code of Conduct, so please be amazing to one another, as we always are. With that said, first person on our agenda is the Venerable Michael Lieberman. Go ahead, my man, all you.
Thanks. So I know a few people had expressed interest in understanding a little bit more about reproducible builds, and specifically around some of the tools out there that can help help out with that, in particular Nix and Bazel. Can you all see my screen?
Yep.
Cool. Okay, so as most folks on the call know, when you're, for example, building an image or building a binary, a lot of things can cause that binary to not be reproducible or not be deterministic. Some of those things just being stuff like, oh, you know, you didn't realize you updated a package, and now that package is used by, let's say, GCC somewhere down the chain. And now you run compile and, you know, yesterday it was giving you one hash, this time it's giving you a, you know, a different hash. And so what can we start to do to maybe, you know, make these things more reproducible, make them more deterministic? So there's a tool out there called Nix, which is a, it's a package manager, it's an operating system, it's a build system, it's a whole lot of things. But for the sake of this demo, it's going to be used to build a Docker image. Now, this is what the config for it looks like. Just real quickly, all I'm including in this Docker image here is Bazel and GCC. And by and large, that is literally the only thing that will be in the image. There is no shell, no you know, no shell utilities, none of that. And the thing here also is that you know, this is a little bit different than a Docker file. And the way it's constructed is, you know, largely this will always produce the same hash. And also in general, like they try and enforce stuff like don't reach out to the internet for things. So yeah, let me just run it. So
can I
let me
just ask you a quick question?
Sure.
I don't want to be too pedantic, but you said largely generate the same hash, which implies...
So what I'd say is there are cases where you can break that, right? You can always kind of figure out a way to be like, actually do this really dumb thing. And it's going to try and prevent you in most cases. And in fact, you need to essentially tell it, hey, I am doing something that is not reproducible. And I'm not going to go too deep into that, but there's like, it's sort of like the equivalent of like unsafe or something like that.
Yeah, yeah. I guess I inferred that you were suggesting this specific
like, oh no. This file. This should always produce the same hash. But if you were to, you know, tell it, I don't know, wget, you know, the front page of the New York Times or something like that, it's going to include that, and then that will always generate a different hash based on that. So I just ran this. You'll see there's literally no images inside of my Docker here. And so now it's just as simple as Nix build default.nix here. So what this is doing is this is reaching out to the internet. The way that Nix sort of works behind the scenes basically is everything is a hash of its inputs and a hash of its outputs. So it will always, it can pull, for example, from the cache because it knows, it can pull from a public cache because it knows that, hey, these inputs led to these outputs. If you didn't, you know, for the sake of speed, I'm just pulling from their Nix stuff, from their Nix cache, the public Nix cache, but I could just as easily say, actually, I want you to build 100% of everything from source. And it should also still generate literally the same hashes. It would just take a very long time. So what this is doing is generating a bunch of layers for the images. And all of these things are just sort of different layers. They can all sort of be validated in different ways. And that's through a thing called like the derivation, right? I just copied from the previous one, the previous time I ran this demo, just to for speed purposes. But pretty much it looks, a Nix derivation is essentially a list of its inputs and a list of its outputs. And it's similar to something like a software bill of materials. Not quite, but probably could write some sort of translation layer for it. But the basic idea here is I can see that this led to this output, right? Which is Nick's derivation is essentially just it's some metadata associated with the output of running a Nix build. And so, you know, I can say this is the output, and then these are all of the inputs, right? So it used a essentially a builder for the container. It pulled in a standard Linux environment while building it. It had to pull in a version of Bash to build the container. It had to pull in fake root and had to pull in Bazel and GCC. And it also provides some information around what was the actual build command and so on and so forth. Okay, so now I have, it's a gzipped tarball of the image. I can now ingest that image. It's gonna take a couple of seconds here, but after it's done, it should be literally this same digest, right? I should be getting the same exact checksum every single time I run this, because the way that Nix works, right, is even though I'm pulling in packages here like Bazel 4 and GCC, currently the way that Nix handles this is they say that your entire universe of packages that is available to you is versioned and hashed, meaning that if you wanted to update, you know, Bazel or whatever, you know, to some new version, you would need to update the pack. You would need to update the package definition, and then also update your version of Nix packages, so that it knows, for example, okay, how does this fit in the scheme of things? Okay, so now the image is in here, and now if I do, if I just get the hash, you'll see both the tag and the hash are literally all the same here, right? And that will always be the case, because Nix will only pull in, literally the only stuff it pulls in is the stuff that's coming from this derivation. It will not pull anything else in from the system. It will only pull in what is listed here. Okay, so then, so now I have this, and so now what I can do is I have the sort of example C++ tutorial from Bazel. And so I'll run that as a Docker container. It's pulling in the source, pulling in the cache here. And so also the other thing to point out is that there was nothing in the cache. It's going to go and compile it. Okay, so that's compiled. And if I do the same thing as before, right, if I just take a SHA-SUM here, you'll see here is the SHA-SUM of the binary it created. This is the same SHA-SUM as before. And if I were to show you, like, hey, if I were to run this, let's say locally, it's going to give me a different, it's going to give me a different SHA-SUM. And you'll see it gives me a different one. And the reason being is, on my local host, I have different versions of different things installed. My local VM here is largely, it's not deterministic, right? I'm running RHEL, I'm installing packages as I see fit to do dev work, yada, yada. Meaning that, you know, when I actually run a build, like depending on what version of GCC I pulled in, or if I updated something, millions of different things can cause that to be a different hash. And so Bazel plus Nix sort of enforces that thing of, like, Bazel enforces what libraries you're pulling in, what sources you're pulling in, enforces all of that sort of stuff. And Nix provides the sort of build infrastructure piece of, hey, only the build infrastructure, the only tools that are included in my build environment are things that are explicitly called out, and then those and the dependencies for the explicit things that are called out. So that's the basics of the demo there. There's a couple other small things just to kind of go over if folks were just sort of interested. But, like, as an example here, once again, here's the container derivation, right? This tells you what were the inputs to that container, and you could always trace through this. these derivations themselves then also have their own inputs, and you can actually see that as well in various ways. Like you can actually just pull out literally here are all the hashes of everything that was used to compose that image, right? Of just, and there might be duplicates in here. Here is what the tree looks like. So I'm not gonna go too deep into it, but Nix builds out like a Merkle tree of all the dependencies. So, you know, a given hash of, let's say, a container or something you've built is essentially just a Merkle tree of all of its inputs and dependencies. And so that goes all the way up the chain. So you could always trace back to exactly what was included as part of it. And that helps out with the ability to sort of do the reproducibility and determinism of that of the build.
Michael, what would you say? I'm just thinking about Nix in general in terms of its usability, right? Yep. You know, Nix and NixOS is, you know, it's if you think about it, let's just say like we have this thing where we're defining like, you know, the hash, and this is what is deterministic. But what if somebody needs to change it? You know, that's the problem that I see, is the adaptability and the adoption aspect of it, right? But I mean, yep. The concept itself is great. Hey, here's signed, you know, digest, and you have to figure out like if it correlates. That to me is just a universal concept that we should just figure out whatever the mechanism is, right?
Yep, I totally agree with you on that, and that's why I'm not necessarily saying, hey, we should all use Nix. With that said, though, I think Nix does buy us certain things. I also think that the approach Nix takes seems to be the right sort of approach. If somebody could figure out a way to make it simpler and easier to adopt, I think that would be great. You know, because I think it takes a similar approach to Bazel, right? Bazel also does something similar where it builds a tree of the dependencies and hashes everything and whatnot. But, you know, Bazel is also, I think, in my experience, a little bit easier to use. So I'm definitely on board with you there. There are a few things that Nix is doing recently. One of the things is called Nix Flakes, which I'm just starting to kind of get into now, which is this idea of you can generate a sort of hash validated package. And also, you know, where you no longer need to say, hey, the only stuff in this universe is the Nix packages universe. You can now say, hey, I am pulling from this GitHub, but I am expecting these hashes that are coming out of that package, and I'm expecting these input hashes. And all of that would then be validated by your system when you would pull all that in, which now allows you to sort of pull a package from, you know, not having to sort of rely on either Nix or relying on you yourself building literally the whole universe. So that's definitely something that is worthwhile to look into. I do agree that, like, at the end of the day, Nix is its own language, right? This is a Nix language. It's used by Nix. It's, in my opinion, it's not super complicated, but for folks who maybe aren't super familiar with stuff like, for folks who are not, let's say, experienced with stuff like Lisp or OCaml and those sorts of like functional programming languages, this could prove to be a little bit difficult to understand. But also at the same time, you know, I think that there's just trade-offs we can make, right? Where you can say, hey, Nix maybe makes sense for something like a core build image, right? Where you're saying this build image is going to be building a whole bunch of stuff. There's only going to be a handful of these things. Using something like Nix or even using something like Bazel to build that is maybe pretty reliable, you know, is maybe simple enough to kind of do. And then you say for actions where we can't get that determinism, we can't get that reproducibility, we focus more on stuff like InToto to sort of provide attestations on the inputs and outputs. That's just my opinion, though.
So Michael, if I'm trying to understand the upgrade scenario here when you wanted to do an update or something like that. So take, for example, GCC, the package there. Mm-hmm. If something needed to update with that one, bug fix, whatever comes out, what's the process? Do you say GCC underscore two?
So there's a couple of different ways to do that. So the first way is literally, so Nix packages is itself a sort of like, there is a literally a checksum for all the Nix packages in the universe, right? And every time they release a new version of Nix packages, which is like once a month or so, they will release, hey, here's all the new Nix packages. Here's all of the new Nix packages. And so you would say, okay, well, I want to update all my Nix packages. That will now update the entire universe of Nix packages. Now, in certain cases, for example, if Basil 4 doesn't rely on this new GCC or whatever, and that hasn't updated, then the hash of this Basil will always be the same. But if this one changed, then the hash for this one will change. There's also another way where if you wanted to use unstable packages, which is just sort of an update, like a constantly updated version of, as a new patch comes in, you could just pull in that patch. You just say, okay, I now want to update. It will generate new hashes. But you'll also, the thing to be clear about, the thing that you still get this derivation where all of these hashes will change and you can trace through.
Yeah, but if you're truly doing a reproducible, you need to not only know this file content, but also the version of that universal packages, whatever month you check that out from.
Correct, but that is traceable through here. Like this, all of this will tell you all the different versions that were used for here and their checksums, right? Like I know that this was using LNDIR 1.0.3 with this hash. And if LNDIR change, right, is 1.0.4, this will be a different hash, which means the output hash will also be different. But we'll still get to keep that traceability.
But this is the output, right? This isn't an input to our build. This is the output of the build, correct?
Correct.
Okay. Yeah. I'm thinking of anybody that wants to try to go through and reproduce something that they see sitting out there on the internet, and they might come around a month later. They just need to know what version of whatever went into it.
Yeah. And so there's a couple of different, like there are the stable packages, and you can say, hey, we are based, this is based off of this version of the stable packages. And then they would just know, you would just be able to know, okay, as long as they're working off of that version, they will always get the same thing. And that's also where, to some extent, Nix Flakes comes in, which does allow you to, and then also you can do the same thing with Nix itself. You can say, hey, I want to include I can say Nix packages, but I can also give it this specific hash of Nix packages. And then if I give them this file, they will always know, they will always pull down from that hash.
Thanks.
Any other questions?
Does the tooling that you've demonstrated so far automatically have something that allows us to validate across different infrastructures? So supposing we did what you just did on, two or more different machines, and we have the outputs, does it provide an easy mechanism for us to actually verify that the hash is matched and all of that? Or is that something that's left to the people using it to verify independently?
So Nix itself doesn't, but there is a thing called Trustix. I will post it in chat here. If I can, I'll post it in chat in a little bit once I stop sharing. There we go, chat. There we go. There's a thing called Trustix, which is a tool that's supposed to be like, hey, you can run, assuming you can run the same Nix build across, let's say, 8 instances. And if you notice, oh, all of the checksums match except for this one, what's going on there? You can sort of do that validation. And so it provides like a, there's some tooling out there that people have built to do that. And then, I mean, the other thing I think is also, I think the other areas where Nix doesn't really handle is sort of the barrier between a lot of these different things. Like, how do you validate that, how do you validate, let's say, the barrier between the reproducible part and the non-reproducible part? And I think that's kind of where InToto comes into play.
Yeah, I think what you just said is kind of related to a thought I had when I looked at the document right before this meeting, because while this does allow us to validate what's going into the build and what's coming out of the build, how do we kind of reconcile this with the non-build stuff, right? Like the inputs that go into the build came from somewhere. So if we're generating attestations with that, and we want to verify with the inputs we're sending it in, sending into the build process here, for example, things like that.
So real quickly, I don't want to take up too much more time here. But I did test out, and I'm not going to run through everything again, but I did test out somewhere around here. Right. So I did test out like creating an Intoto sort of layout. To be clear, this is very much like proof of concept. I'm still learning a lot about Intoto myself, but I do think that you could have, for example, steps in your Intoto layout that are like, imagine the static analysis, the scanning steps, you validate all of that as part of the inputs, right? And then you say, okay, now that we've signed that off, we are reasonably certain that the source code we are ingesting, you know, we're actually about to build, the source code itself doesn't have issues, right? Or we don't think it's been compromised. We don't think that a bad actor has done something bad in here, yada, yada. And you can have Intoto sort of sign that off, and then you can validate that Bazel is the only thing that's building it, right? Like it's building exactly what you told, you know, what Intoto signed off on. I think that's kind of where I see that happening.
Yeah, I think that makes sense to me at this moment. I was earlier a little confused because we seem to be conflating reproducibility and whether, you know, supply chain attestations and whether we should only have attestations and there is no reproducibility and all of that. That's why I have, you know, a couple of questions. But I think we can work through this.
Yeah, the only thing I'd add on there is, yeah, I just think that where possible, obviously reproducibility and determinism, I think, is paramount, but obviously that can't be done across the board. You know, there's all sorts of things that will break that. There's all sorts of tools that currently don't allow that reproducibility, don't allow that determinism. And where those things break, I think that's where all these other supply chain tools come into play to help us reason about it.
Alrighty. Any other questions for Michael? Awesome. I put the links in the document for now that you put in chat. I think I have them all. So I think next up on our agenda, we'll be trying to brainstorm on best practices. I saw the note, and it's funny. So I guess, Michael, one of the steps here was try to enforce through, like, you have this reproducible build process using, you know, Nix and Bazel. You actually demonstrate it, which is really cool. So that's awesome. So do we want to kind of go maybe around the horn and talk through some of these? Let me just link this document so everyone has it as well. The best practices for build process.
Yeah, so I just want to be upfront, just because I know we talked about it a little bit of this last week. A lot of stuff in the document talks about Nix and Bazel. I'm not saying, you know, we absolutely have to use Nix and Bazel. It's just it's the stuff that I'm most familiar with. So I'm just saying, hey, this is what has worked for me. And so here's a specific example. If there are other tools that can handle the same thing that are better suited, definitely we can definitely put that in the doc.
That's a good question for the group. Is there any, like, what you saw today, how would you attack this with other tools, if any? And if there isn't, then, you know, we know what we need to do here.
I think so distroless covers some of the same kind of conceptual ground. And it's built with Bazel.
Is there, you know, we know it'd be kind of cool if I can just throw this out there. Maybe somebody could like just demonstrate distroless and similar to the way that Neil Michael did here. Like, you know what I mean? Like, and just say that, you know, so then we can all have this consensus of here's how we would tackle it using other tools. I don't know. I mean, am I asking for a lot here or I'm just kind of like, I'm just throwing that out there.
I would definitely be interested in learning more about distroless.
Same here. Like, cause I haven't seen like I know of the practicality of it, but I just want to see it in actual practice according to what we're doing here to a certain degree. Does anybody want to step up it for like next week maybe? And maybe do something similar? Cole, are you speaking? I think you're on mute. Or maybe not.
No, I'm not. I was just thinking, you know, there's UBI and there's distroless too, right? So I think there's different things that people are using that are very similar.
Yeah, so I think that the mention of UBI raises a good point. What is the concrete goal with these tools? Because not everything that Michael demonstrated with Nix can be achieved with, for example, UBI. Mm-hmm. And I apologize because I'm way behind on this topic. So I came for the demo and don't know kind of what instigated the demo.
Well, there's a, do you need a link to the document to kind of, because the link is in the chat there in terms of like,
yeah,
that has the kind of the idea for the build process there that instigated this to a certain degree.
Sure.
Yeah, I think one thing to add on there. Yeah, I think previous conversations have been focused on like the pipeline itself and sort of attesting to sort of handoffs between the pipeline and, you know, the actual stuff like Tecton steps. But there wasn't really, I think the thing that instigated this was just the, hey, what about the build steps itself? Like what can we do to start securing what is actually happening in a Tecton step? If let's say we're using Tecton, or what is actually happening in the build infrastructure itself?
Cool. So it looks like Josh volunteered you, Brandon.
Yeah, I was just saying I've been toying with some ideas of how to implement this, thinking about a more general use case. Nowhere even remotely close to ready to demo. It's still more very much vaporware, but the thought process I've been having is if this can be done at a network proxy level, where you basically have a network proxy that has digest of everything that's pulled and it knows everything that it touched the network on. And then you can use that to provide that to anybody else that wants to do a reproducible build off the same network connections. There's still other work you have to go into, resetting timestamps, stuff like that, but kind of been toying around with that thought in my head.
Yeah, if you have any questions, definitely interested in having a conversation about that. Also, I think one of the other things I'm curious if anybody's given any thought to, I know I asked it last time, of similar sort of thing with network proxy, but also TPM, like, hey, creating an allow list in a TPM, a VTPM, and actually being able to monitor and enforce that the only sort of artifacts that are being built in, the only sources in a container or the only files that are even used in a container are the files in that, you know, TPM allow list.
Has the Spire project, I know they've been thinking about some of this stuff, and I think there's actually an issue, I'll reference it, about using some TPMs for some stuff like that, doing some binary verification. So I'll post that in Slack.
Hey, Cole, do you mind adding it to the document as well, just so we can kind of keep it here as well?
Oh, yeah,
yeah. Yeah, don't worry, I can... I'm sorry,
I can get it.
Yeah, no worries, man. I appreciate it, bud. Yeah, so again, I think in terms of, you know, best practices, it's, you know, we can probably spend the whole day, but I think we should probably do it more asynchronous at this point. But I think clearly going through some of the user stories. Emily, are you still on? I'm sorry, I didn't read much
of the notes on the user story. I'm still here.
Okay. Sorry, I usually have two screens right now, but so yeah.
So last time when we went through the best practices, it was to make sure that all the questions were answered and that we had clarity in the content that was being recommended with at least one example.
Okay. Is there, do we want to kind of focus a little bit more of that, or we want to give people back their day? I don't know. Like, what do we want to do from that perspective?
So for that one, I checked the document and it had a lot of comments on it. I don't believe that the contents were explicitly adjudicated for the remaining items. So we went through the first three. We got very clear on like what we were talking about. We provided specific examples for someone reading through this to understand how it could potentially be implemented. And then there were, I think we actually got through four of them. So there were several other ones where we didn't get through it. And there were some comments on there. So I wanted to make sure that if the group was interested in finalizing those, that we set aside time to do that, because I felt like we had a good conversation about each of them. If we don't want to do that, then we should go back to the project board and go through those user stories and continue to enumerate those, because those user stories are going to drive the requirements.
Yep. I have to be honest with you. I have to do a more deep dive of it next time. I can have more of an educated kind of response to it and stuff like that. And also would be kind of cool, and I can help to do this, is actually validate this with actual users. You know what I mean? Like at some point be like, hey, you know, we put together, does this sound all right to you? Like, is this something you see in your world? That kind of thing. So that's cool. All right. Anybody else have any thoughts? I would ask for the next meeting if somebody could volunteer to, like, I really want to see distroless to a certain degree, even if, you know, I think the group, just so we have that as something to do, even if, like I said, it's a super rough demo. If somebody wants to volunteer to kind of demonstrate that, that would be pretty awesome. Brandon, sorry, I'm just throwing you out there. Yeah, so again, if you can't, cool. If not, then we can just figure out something else there. Or even, like I said, if UBI doesn't have those capabilities, we're gonna have to figure out something. I think what would be great is to compare and contrast different ways of doing this, and then we can come to a better consensus. All righty. Anyone else have anything else to bring up?
No, I just wanted to, so I added a bunch of specific examples to the doc. So if anybody had any specific thoughts or feel like the specific examples don't seem to fit, you know, definitely looking for feedback on them.
Michael, I'm going to take a deeper look at it. I'm going to be on a plane for 4 hours. So I'm going to read the shit out of it and add some comments. So
for the remainder of the time, do we want to focus on the build process documents, the remaining items that are on there, or do we want to go through the user stories some more and keep adding to them? I can tell everyone is super excited to do this. Okay. So why don't we go through the user stories? Because that'll help start some of these requirements, and it might drive some good conversations later about those best practices. So if everybody can pull up the project board for where we started. And as a refresher, one of the goals of going through this is to think more about what our consumers of the reference architecture are intending to get out of this. Not only get out of it as a consumer, but as an operator, as a developer, and potentially go even further to be more specific about the design of the reference architecture and be more prescriptive with what it is that we're looking to do. So we've identified four primary users of an operator, a developer, a security professional, and a compliance officer or auditor. We've gone through and we've generated user stories for nearly all of them, but they're not they're not detailed enough. We do have one outstanding requirement of deciding whether or not we want to recommend a shared volume in TPM or lock down the build or just a container to do that, to pull from known internal mirrors and IPs for implementation of implement detection of traffic ingress and egress that doesn't match the rules defined. So the request was everybody think about if you, in your current position, are using the reference architecture, what do you want out of it? If you're an operator looking to set it up, what do you want to be able to do? We've already covered, you want to be able to set it up and tear it down just so you can provide value to your senior leadership team and get buy-in from them. As a developer, I believe we mentioned that you want to be able to extend it or at least look through what already exists and get feedback in case of a security violation. So what other things do folks have? Okay, OG says automating the release process. Can you expand on that?
Yeah, looks like it takes forever to type. So just a brief, hi, Ovid Ginet here from, I work at UBS. We already started in parallels about a year and a half ago to look at a GraphQL reference implementation. And for us, we wanna make sure that we don't duplicate the current release process, which is manual, right? Based on certain controls which are implemented inside the corporate. That we want to leverage as much as possible the attestations and the metadata generated by the build and by the pipeline to make sure that we are able to fulfill the compliance requirements automatically. So we want to aim to use the metadata as a way to satisfy the release process governance and the required evidences.
Kind of ties into a thought I had seen these last time, which was that we had a lot of pieces in here where we're saying we're going to notify the security department if something didn't follow the right steps, and we're going to give people some visibility when things don't work like they're supposed to. And going through my head is, you know, I just want to design a system that doesn't require all this manual intervention. I want this thing to just work out of the box and just be secure and not have to have people turning knobs to make it work right.
Exactly. To some extent, you want people to only seek a manual only if it's an exception. Otherwise, by default, we should be able to infer the metadata.
Agreed. I think, does anyone think that that stuff like security review or anything like that requires a specific call out? Because that is very much a manual step in that whole process.
So I believe based off of the conversation that we had, the security professional alerting was more around when a rule or another change occurred that didn't match a defined policy. So one of the items that we talked about was that when a change to the rule had occurred that didn't follow the development path that was defined or the approvals that were defined. So I believe the expectation there is that once we've defined what that policy looks like, everything should be automated. And the only exception is if a force has to happen. So a scenario could potentially be that there is an incident and they need to push an update to the architecture, or they need to push an update out to their given environment. What does that actually look like? What's the break glass procedure in place? For me, I'm thinking you need to have a human being actually review that just to kind of double check and say, yeah, there's a corresponding incident. It can integrate with our ticketing system. Or if it's like the world's on fire, there's a bypass mechanism to bypass that just to get it done. And then there's an after effect.
Yeah, I guess the place I'm coming from is I feel like if you've got the code reviewer section that says, or code owners that say that the policy change has to be approved by the security department, it should just be approved by the security department. There should be a method to, the break glass is get someone on the phone right now to hit the approve button on this thing, and then we can sort through the fire later on. It shouldn't be notified when we completely bypass the process that's in place.
Agreed. I think in that particular use case, as long as the changes to those rules were defined within the code, it's following the general approval process to begin with. Whether or not we want to define that a security person has to be one of the two approvers prior to merge, that can be a configurable item. But ideally, a security person, unless you've got a unicorn, they're not going to be sitting there doing the code review and fully comprehend everything that's going on. They're going to want to just they want to focus on one thing, and they want to do it really well, and they want to stay out of your way if they're good at what they do.
So I think my question is, can we codify that? Can we have automated policy enforcement for this release process, right? If the policy we define is you can't use GPL licenses in your open source projects, and we have a bill of material and we store all of this somewhere, or we have some system that can look at what are the licenses for all of the items in the bill of material. Can we have a OPA policy or something else that actually stops you from deploying or releasing those container images without having any of that manual?
I'm sorry to cut you off. To me, that would be some type of emission controller integration. And again, Pouting Falco does some of this work in terms of that. So that's first piece. But OPA obviously is more for the conditional aspects of it. So we don't have to, I'm sorry to interrupt you. We don't have to engineer right now for that. But yeah, that absolutely has to happen where it's a complete shutdown if one of those things are violated. Sorry to cut you off, John.
No, that's okay. And I think I heard mention of Graphia saying this was something I talked about a couple of weeks ago. And I think I don't know if there's a recommendation we can make around that space, but it'd be really interesting to have a central place to do all of this policy and generate all that policy from.
So last time we talked about the deployment versus the build. So which one do we want to focus on for this? Do we want to do both? We want to stop a build
audio issues
from actually occurring.
Vitya, can you repeat? I couldn't hear you.
So I, the way we're looking at it in my case is that we are defining a metadata type to just justify the evidences for, let's say, SAST scanning, right? And we can produce that as a based on a tool that would generate that metadata type coming out of a manual approver or directly from the build, if generating that from the SAST scan, just to give an example, right? But we want to look at the governance at simply checking if that evidence exists, regardless if it was created manually or if it came directly from the build. Then that's how we want to look at it.
So Cole, correct me if I'm wrong, I remember you mentioning something about Intoto being able to provide out of band attestations as well.
Right. So Intoto has the concept of a layout, right? And that layout is the policy that your build has to go through. So each individual step of the build is signed and attested for individually, right? And the policy is if the policy is satisfied, that's a layout, that provides the out-of-band attestation, right? So I can take these attestations, move them around wherever I want to. And then as long as those attestations match that policy, right, that gives us that out-of-band validation that artifact is what that artifact matches the policy that we created. right now, a lot of time, what people are doing is they're relying that on the build process that those steps were followed, right? So you have some sort of a manual review of your build templates or your build process that is in band with like your CI/CD team, right? So if there's a compromise somewhere in that build process, there's no out of band way to validate that is what you expected to be, right? Unless you're using something like Intoto where you can sign each one of those steps and sign that metadata and then verify that in your policy, and then you write a policy that says, hey, the metadata should match these constraints. And if it does, then you have that.
Since I heard the Intoto layout being specified, I want to make sure that I understand it right, what was mentioned before. But in my view, I think we are creating a layout and then we have sub layouts and a sub layout for the CI space and maybe additional sub layouts for manual approvers and other steps that could be done out of band. Does this make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
And then I think even if you have that, going back to like the build versus deployment, and there's probably two very large sections we could go into here, right? Like if you have all your Intoto layouts and verification and things like that, and you don't connect that with when you're actually deploying software, as different compromises happen in the future or software becomes out of date, like having some central place to check for that policy and if it's still valid or the software, the artifacts are still usable would be, I think, important.
Yes, but to some extent, all the evidence exists individually. Layout is a way of structuring that data. And I think if we look at the individuality of the evidences, we wrote additional verifiers at various levels, not necessarily relying on layout, but because of the way we architect the evidences, we would know that this particular additional metadata type, regardless if it came from a layout step or not, needs to be present for a deployment to a control environment to happen. So we're looking at that particular evidence as an individuality, or if you look at that layout, it's just a way to structure them. But the reality is that it's like a dossier, right? The artifact does have all the evidences or it doesn't have them, regardless if they come from a layout or if they come out of band.
Okay, so the security professional one that we talked about for the approval, I've made the adjustment based off of this discussion. And then I added one about out-of-band attestations to generate metadata by which the release can be automated when all required conditions are met. And I added the other one about stopping the deployment and the build when the expected state or policy is not met. So those are all captured. Are there any others? Or do we think that we're at a good place that we could potentially start breaking these apart into actual tasks? Knowing full well that we might think of others as we go through this.
I think it's good to get that minimal viable thing out. Again, I'm of the mind that you kind of can keep on adding clay to the sculpture as you're growing it out and all that fun stuff. So yeah, I mean, if the rest of the group agrees.
Cool.
Thumbs up. Awesome.
So next steps for this are, I guess, everybody picks one of these user stories and starts breaking it apart about what actually needs to be done to make them true. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Glad I'm not going insane. All right, so there are quite a few of these. If everybody could pick one to start and break it up into more finite tasks, be opinionated again, requesting everybody be opinionated on this, and be specific on any additional software, open source, commercial, whatever, that can assist in making that possible.
So how do we deliver that? Or
you all should have access to create cards on this board, hopefully.
So just additional cards.
Additional cards. And I believe we can maybe create cards on top of them. So let me go through and create a numbering schema. And then as you create cards, you can refer back to the numbering schema. Does that work?
Yeah, I was trying to figure out the nesting of this. So yeah,
yep. That helps. Okay. Does that work for everybody? Pop, does this make sense? You're the PM.
Makes complete sense. And also I've added that some of the takeaways and follow-ups to the document, as well as a link to the board, and all of the links that were discussed today, just so we can defer to them in the meeting notes. I've been a busy beaver while you all are doing the really good work. So, all righty, busy beaver. All right, you all, we good? You ready to change the software supply chain securely world together? Let's do it. Have a good rest of the day, you all.
Later.
Bye, y'all. Thank you.